find out, just we continue to work with the coastal.
Is the idea that you're just going to pile the sand on top of this stuff? Is that what's going on?
Yeah, the initial plan is to put the sand out to do the protection so we don't have to place more rock or sandbags and see if that works this year. It gives it improved access in the interim period. It allows us to continue to work with the Coastal Commission in the spur planning process to see what the interim ultimate, you know, fix for Ocean Beach is going to be in that area. So, you know, and if that means, you know, I mean, if we remove it now and we get the erosion, I got to bring them back in, and that doesn't make sense. At least they're a backup. If the erosion, if this plan doesn't work, because this is kind of a test and we're going to be monitoring the erosion rate over the winter, you know, at least the revetments will be there, you know, to protect the infrastructure, and then we'll have to go to plan B. You know, if this works, you know, ultimately we understand that those revetments will have to be removed and there's going to be some type of other structure that's going to go in its place, maybe, or, you know, we're still looking at those options, and that's the phase two of the implementation of the task order that's coming out with the spur planning process. So those discussions are going to continue. That's not changing. We're moving forward to see what that, you know, 80-year, 100-year plan is for the beach, so we can come up with a either a protection or a relocation or whatever it is that everybody wants that fits within that plan. So, you know, to remove it now, I think, is a little premature. And so we know what we can do that works for you guys and works for us to protect the infrastructure while we go through this process with you to figure out what the longer-term fix is going to be for the area.
Then what is the NEPA CEQA process? Are you going to do any EIR, any EIS on this?
Well, that... Marla mentioned the long-term fix for this, and it, the concepts came out in the master plan. That will more than likely trigger an EIR, EIS on that. What we're looking at here for all the sand that we're bringing in, we are doing NEPA CEQA on it. Part of this meeting is the public outreach part of those processes. But we know that all the sand that we're bringing out there is going to be sacrificial. It's going to go back into the littoral system. It's not going to last, and it's not designed to be able to last for a long period of time. So it's that interim fix that we want to implement so we don't have to put any more rock, you know, or any more sandbags out there. It's that soft solution until the longer-term master plan and longer-term fix gets implemented. Much rather have this type of solution than
the
rocks.
Regarding the long-term fix, does the city have any planning process underway to make that happen?
Yeah, we're next week at our commission meeting, we're approving the next funding of the spur task order with the Park Service. There's, you know, an $800,000 contract going out to advance this planning process. It's the actual implementation phase from this draft plan we just proceeded. So we're moving full steam ahead.
What's that, with that mission?
The SFPUC.
And you're giving $800,000?
It's a task order to spur for the continued planning process of the implementation and working.
It's not a governmental agency. I don't see, that's not anything that you could ever submit to the Coastal Commission unless they're going to be like a third party.
I don't think that would be submitted to the Coastal Commission. What that's going to give us, it's going to give us the concepts and the alternatives that everybody in this room and the city and the Park Service can agree to that we can put into an actual permit process for the Coastal Commission and take it through that formal process. I don't think we have that yet. You know, and that's what we need to continue. That's what this process does. It's working with you to get something that's going to work for everybody in this room. And that's kind of what our objective is for this, but we need some time to get there because we know we're not there now. There's, you know, there have been a lot of, you know, issues with us just placing rock out there because we haven't addressed the concerns or looked at all these alternatives to push them forward. So we're really trying to go through that process at this point.
Go ahead, Bill.
I was going to say, I'm Bill Novak with the Certified Foundation. We would just suggest that, you know, since we know that we're almost certain that this sand will be sacrificial and be reabsorbed into the system, we would suggest that at least, you know, the idea of rubble cleanup removal is, you know, seriously considered, and we think it'd be a really good idea because once the sand melts back into the system, we're back to square one where we have very dangerous rubble and debris lining the shoreline. We have scouring effect from all that structure sitting down there right now, access issues, safety issues, and all that stuff. So our organization would like, you know, all these agencies here to seriously consider doing that.
Based on erosion information from the Corps of Engineers and their environmental assessment, I think we believe that, you know, the sand could last, you know, 3 to 5 years before we get back to that point. So our project does include, you know, removal of any kind of rebar, protrusions, anything, you know, remove them, kind of clean up the rubble, not remove the rubble, but try to remove any kind of protrusion dangers that we see down there before we do put the sand over it. And then plan on dealing with the cleanup and the removal or whatever has to happen, you know, once we know what we're going to be, you know, doing or not doing on the beach for the longer term.
I mean, you guys have seen that there's been a lot of settlement and sloughing of the rubble to the point where it's covering a lot of area of beach. There's garbage cans sitting out in the sand, fencing that's been thrown down there. There's a lot of cleanup and stuff we really think should happen. Right.
And that's going to be one requirement that we have for the project, is that any hazardous debris that's out there has to be picked up before the sand gets placed on any of that rubble.
And one last thought, I mean, even if you can't, you know, remove a lot of that hard structure, if you at least realign it backwards, you would daylight more beach and therefore have that much more, you know, you at least forestall the scouring effects that will eventually occur once that sand melts back into the system. Like to forward that idea out there and we both will consider.
A couple things. First, I think it's a great idea, so I'm really glad you're doing it. With regard to the trucks going on the highway, it's summer, the sand's pretty firm, I was just out there. Is there a possibility just driving the trucks right down the beach? Or is that a plover issue?
It's a plover issue.
Okay, all right. So that was one.
It's a plover issue and it's a visitor experience issue. But one of the things that's interesting that's been floated is actually if there continues to be an excess amount of sand in this north area, maybe there is a better way of doing it, you know, slurrying it or something
well,
like
that. That was going to be the second thing. I know as part of the Ocean Beach Task Force, I was talking to one of the engineers there, and he was saying that one of the things that's done on beaches around the world is a slurry thing. We basically get a big pipe, mix it with water, make mud, pull the mud from one place, pump it to another. So has that been considered for this purpose?
We couldn't implement it. It was considered, but the timing of it, we couldn't implement it for this. But it's certainly it's an alternative that's been brought forward to consider in the future. Sure.
Okay, great. Thanks. Mm-hmm. Yes. Is there any consideration, or is it reasonable in any way to do a perpendicular seawall and rock? Because I understand that when you do a perpendicular wall, that the sand seems to accumulate behind it.
Like a groin or something?
Yes. It draws in any wall, sea wall that you have along the coast, behind it, on the
yeah.
Right, yeah.
Well, for this particular project, no, but for the longer term project, there's a lot of options on the table. And one of the things I mentioned here that there actually is a group here that is looking at sediment management in this whole littoral cell. And we actually have a member of that team that's studying that. And they are looking at different options, groins, and different ways to handle the sediment in this whole littoral cell. So they just got done with a bunch of public meetings. They'll be coming out with a plan for this whole area, and so there's a lot of people looking at different options of managing the sediment in this whole area, and that's one of the things that they're looking at.
One.
Yeah, I think this is the best idea that I've heard from anyone involved in this beach master plan, anything so far. So I'm 100% for it. I would just like to suggest, as you're doing this, if you're able to do it, if you'll notice, when you go down the upper grade highway, there's two or three locations, one around Judah, one around Yoloa, and one around Noriega, where there's enormous sand dunes right on the curb. So they close the grade highway for a week, the guys come with the bulldozers, they clean to the curb, and the dune goes from the curb straight up. As soon as the wind blows, close the grade highway again. Take the sand dunes that are just built up there that have no ice plant on them, put that stuff down there as well. There's your extra sand. That's point number one. And point number two, right now they're already going south from Lincoln Way to Stairwell 21. So I don't see why. If they need more sand, they should be able to do that as well. Third, the logical solution is to take the sand that's dredged annually from the potato patch, 150,000 cubic tons, slurry that and blow that right on top of Slope Beach, put it on top of it. Surf Rider Foundation has 2,000 members in this chapter who will volunteer them to plant native species like they did at Sutro Dunes. I'll volunteer right now. Like they did at Sutro Dunes and spent $2.3 million to bring sand to the beach across the street from Kelly's Cove for that stupid little project. And what you do, and you fill that sand, you leave all that rubble down there, and it doesn't matter. You bury that, because the whole beach is already way further than it ever was before. They did that when they made Golden Gate Park and they made a Sundeck District. It never was there, so you're never going to get it back to where it was. Don't even bother trying. Bury that thing. And regarding jetties, you use the same technique. You use the sand slurry in the summertime. They dredge that stuff in May, and you try a sand jetty first as a test model before you ever put any riprap rock in there and see how it works. And you put it just right there south of Slope Beach, straight out, 50 yards wide, 300 yards out, and 20 feet high. And blow that sand in and see what happens. See if that doesn't cut off that longshore current. And if it doesn't work, what's the worst thing that happens? It ends up, all the sand ends up right back on Slope Beach, where you would have to truck it there anyways. And furthermore, and Surf Rider Foundation will volunteer right here now to put down sand ladders like they've got at Fort Funston, so you will have access at Sloat, at Second Parking Lot, for example, five accesses between Fort Funston and Sloat Beach where there's a sand ladder, so you keep people off the dunes for native restoration so the ice plant and the stuff can take hold and hold it in.
I wasn't taking notes. You have all that written down somewhere.
So let me address one of the points that you had there, taking the dredged sand and placing it on the beach. So the Army Corps, I hate to bash another federal agency, but they don't really do a good job in outreach. They actually just approved a plan where they would permanently take the disposal site and bring it off of this erosion hotspot and get it designated permanently there. In addition, they've approved a plan where they can actually do beach nourishment and slurry that off of the dredge ship and put it on the shoreline. So that's in process, and that's approved. They just have to find the funding and get the right equipment.
When you get the EIS off their website, so they've already got the documents and studies of doing that, exactly what you just said.
I know where they can get $800,000.
So one
of the things, I mean, we had a meeting with the Corps of Engineers. The Escion isn't retrofitted to do the slurry pumping to the beach, so I think they're looking at renting a dredge to come down here next year or the year after to do that. So they are looking at, the option of, it does require a beach structure to receive it and for placing it on the beach and then the equipment and how they do this. I know they're working on that and looking at those options. And also getting the appropriate equipment in place to be able to do that.
So I want to give a little bit of a plug to this regional sediment management group, and we do have somebody here, Bob Battaglia, who's on the team that's working on that, and I'll give them a little plug, and Bob, give you a little time to maybe talk about how you're studying these issues and coming up with recommendations throughout the whole littoral cell.
Well, sure, if you want. And actually, I know a lot of the folks here, but we have another public meeting Thursday evening in Pacifica, I believe it is. But anyway, if I can give you my card and you can contact me. So we're having a second public meeting. It should be similar to the one we had last Thursday. It's for downtown to make it convenient for people. And we're basically studying sand transport in the area and identifying ways to mitigate coastal erosion by affecting the sand supply. So there's some erosion problems that are due to limited sand availability. And also we are looking at some of these options. This would be called backpassing, where you figure the sand's mostly moving from south to north, and you take it from the north and put it on the south. And it's kind of an ongoing operation. And so that's one option that we'll be looking at. And so, but otherwise, we're separate from this project, and you know, we're just dealing with some of the same issues. And I did have a couple of comments, if you were interested. You know, I appreciate your thought about removing the dunes, but actually one way you might consider mitigating the onshore sand transport by wind is, I think, alluded to in your first sketch, where you have that kind of mound or hump-like form. And when you have that very wide sand beach that's very dry, and we have any kind of wind, I mean, you're going to get wind transport. So looking at it as a geomorphologist might, or you know, the wind is basically trying to build dunes, and it just happens to be doing it where we don't want it. But one thing you might want to consider is trying to construct the, or you know, grade it so you form dunes a little farther off the seawall, and eventually maybe even plant it if that's consistent with the uses. We had there's a recent experience down at Ventura where this has just been done, and just dumping some sand without actually getting plants established yet, because about the growing season, actually seemed to reduce the onshore wind transport. So, you know, it's something to think about.
I'm sorry, can you say that again? Where would you want it to be?
Well, the idea is that if you have a dry sand beach, the wind will form it.
Yeah.
That's why they exist. Mm-hmm. And so if you try to maintain the beach very flat, you actually create more work for yourself. And so, not that I think anyone's trying to do that necessarily here, because we have plenty of flat beach, but the idea is a little counterintuitive, and that is to perhaps try to build a low dune berm so that it deflects the wind and induces deposition right behind the dune rather than blowing the sand.
It's kind of the...
Where would that be relative to the beach and relative to the seawall?
Well, it would have to be... you know, off away from the seawall, say, you know, 40, 50 feet, or
okay,
could be farther
so
off.
Close-ish to the seawall.
Right? It doesn't have to. It could be farther out. We have 800 feet of unusually wide beach.
And the idea is it works if you've seen snow fences.
Sure.
Any kind of structure will reduce the velocity of that sand and deposit it right behind that structure. So if you see any kind of structure out on these wind-blown beaches, you can see the sand build up, you know, a post or whatever it is. It's that same concept.
It might be worth a try. I mean, it's a little bit of an art, I think, to try to get dunes to form, and then when you get plants, the wind's going to blow the sand around still, but
okay.
It might help. And the other comment I was going to make is, I'm glad you're using the road, because there are living things in the beach, and they do have, as you know, the Park Service and sand crabs and other things. And so if we ran a lot of trucks on the beach, I mean, it could have an adverse effect. So I think the road, as inconvenient as it is, probably does affect the environment less than driving on the beach. And then, historically, you know, we did place sand where that lower little sand berm blue thing is, which was a recommendation from the Ocean Beach Task Force. That was placed in the early 2000s, I think, twice, wasn't it, right?
Three times.
And so we know that it probably will erode. That sand was, as you said, and that sand was, I think, much coarser than this sand. So it actually did better than we thought it would. But it lasted several years, and it's partly dependent on the conditions. But I think that we know that the sand probably will erode, and so therefore the rubble, unfortunately, will still be there exposed at some point in the future. And I think we could still remove it, but I would, you know, like to echo the surf rider folks as one of the beach users that rubble is really a problem. So, you know, to the extent that it could be removed, that's, I think, where we're all headed. Whether or not, you know, you can do that now or whatever, I guess I'll leave that up to you all. See, I was going to make one other comment. I don't want to meddle too much, but I'm just... It would be good maybe if you had some sort of access ways, or after you place the sand, maybe look at it and see if there's some ramps or something for people, because you know, the sand might be a little loose, and you know, if you can get maybe a little bit of a beach so that people can walk between the water and the dunes, or get back up onto the, I'm just thinking about, you know, access for people. Just a thought. I don't, you know, I guess you you almost have to wait and see how it spreads out.
Yeah, and we actually have talked about that, access points and how to create the right slope to get people down off that bluff, because that bluff, as you all know, you can't get down off there very easy. So we want to enhance the access, and that's one of the conditions that the Coastal Commission will put on us. They're all about having beach access. So.
Your idea of having some sort of little ramp, like,
sand lab.
Yeah, and I see these little rubber mats. I don't know. I mean, you never know out there. It's hard to know how long anything's going to last, but just a
great. Thanks, Bob, for the comments.
Some of these ideas may have merit, and so that's brings me back to the CEQA and the Coastal Act compliance schedule or framework. You talked about cleaning up some of the more dangerous obstacles out there. Is there going to be like a project description with the various components somewhere where we can look at this? One thing that comes to mind is those poles that are out in the water. There's steel poles out there that were placed in the early 2000s, kind of a harebrained scheme to measure sea rise. It didn't work, or at least there was no positive results ever reported from that. But that seems like something that might be an easy thing to be part of this project. Are the poles going to be removed?
Well, that's the first suggestion we had on the poles. We've gotten a lot of suggestions to remove the rubble that's out there, and we're making the step to remove any hazardous rubble out there. So we'll take that into consideration. I know eventually those poles will be taken out, but they weren't planned in this project. But that's we'll take that under consideration. The thing with the rubble right now is that nobody likes the rubble. The Park Service doesn't like the rubble. The public doesn't like the rubble. But right along this bluff, this is where the rubble is falling out of the bluff and through here. It is providing some toe protection for that bluff, even though it's sort of ramping up and maybe increasing some of the erosion at the upper end of that bluff. It is protecting the toe. So if that rubble wasn't there and you didn't have something else behind that, you would probably likely be potentially eroding that bluff where you're having to do more emergency actions to protect that infrastructure. But hopefully, you know, with this amount of sand that's going to be placed out there, this long berm, this amount of sand, we will be maybe making the actual beach conditions, that beach width, at least in this interim period, a little larger, because right now that we've lost all the beach in that area. Hopefully we'll get some of that back with this project.
Yeah, I just want to say, you know, so far we totally, you know, support this as an interim measure, but we want to make the point that, you know, in the big picture, we have long-term erosion pattern at the south end of the beach, and basically the ocean's going to get that land one way or the other. We're just kind of forestalling time, and I think we want to take example of what happens on the East Coast, where millions and millions of dollars are dumped into this type of sand management practice year after year after year, and they never really come up with a solution that kind of lasts.
So I'm curious, Surfrider, have they endorsed the concepts in the Spur Master Plan of how to deal with this this erosion hotspot?
We definitely support the beach restoration aspects, however, and we do recognize there needs to be some sort of a sand placement aspect to a restoration plan. Mm-hmm. But the whole concept of leaving the Lake Merced tunnel in place, we're a bit more skeptical on. We want to see a thorough analysis of that, and we also really believe it's a relocation or a realignment of that of the tunnel should be considered, particularly given this fact that we do have sea level rise and long-term erosion pattern at the south end of the beach. It was just, I guess at the time when all this stuff was going in, they knew that this would be a problem, but, you know, the city went ahead and put inside of the things there anyway, so, it's just one of those things where, okay, that's what's done is done. How do we proceed from here? And I think we don't want to, you know, take a cue from a lot of the things that happen on the East Coast where you're just constantly dumping millions and millions of dollars into sand that washes away year after year.
That's a good comment.
Can I piggyback? Well, actually, since he's talking about dollar sign, what is 100 250,000 cubic yard equal to in the amount of dollar, would you say?
In about 100,000 yards that we're looking at moving here for our contract, that's going to cost us around $600,000.
But if you were to go out to buy the sand to replenish the beach, how much would that cost? Do you know? Have you guys
I don't know what the unit price of sand is.
It would be more than that. That's a pretty good price, actually.
So how much? A couple million dollars?
Yeah.
So what happened? Okay, I represent the north end of Ocean Beach. And basically what you guys are doing is removing commodity from the north end of Ocean Beach. And we would basically, you know, maybe you guys can do something nice for us up there, like public restroom on a short-term fix.
Yeah.
How about that?
So,
I mean,
I second that.
That's a couple million dollars you guys are basically, you know, taking away from us.
Maybe I can help. The city is generating millions of dollars by selling the beach for the marathons and all the events that go out there almost every single weekend. Maybe some of that money could be returned to the west side.
That would be a first.
Yeah.
So through the whole master planning process, one of the biggest issues from the public is the restroom issue. And the Park Service and the city are not going to let that whole process kind of play through before we address that issue. Okay. There's going to be some one of the first actions, even before a larger plan gets adopted, there will be some of those amenities that are done, and restrooms is at the top of the list. So.
Could you say that again?
Throughout the whole SPUR master plan process, one of the issues that have come up from the public over and over again is the lack of restrooms, especially in that north part of the area. So the planners, as part of that project, have taken that to heart and are planning restrooms in those areas. I can't tell you when they're going to get in, but you won't have to wait till these larger plans get implemented. You will see some of those high priority items implemented as soon as funding becomes available.